Good evening. I'd like to open the Deerfield Planning Board meeting on August 1st, 2016, at 7 o'clock here at the town offices at Conway Street in South Deerfield. Our agenda tonight is to review the minutes of July 11th, hear any public comment, continue the public hearing from July 11th concerning the Allen Chase Foundation and Eagle Brook School, the site plan for ground-mounted solar arrays, and then have some new business. We have two A&Rs, one at 20 Elm Street and one at 30 Keats Road, and then have a discussion of bylaws about dimensional requirements. Then we'll check the mail, set a date for the next meeting. Is there anything else that anybody wants to add to the agenda? Sounds good.
I'm good.
We have the, does everybody have the July 11th minutes? They're right behind
us. The agenda.
We were emailed them the other day too, I think.
Good, John.
Yeah, I just have a couple edits. The last sentence, E, the board discussed the contract. It should refer to with the FERCOG for FY17. Doesn't say anything about what contract it was.
Okay.
So just say with the FERCOG.
Yep.
Missing a D in the sentence before that, laid out. Otherwise, that's what I remember.
What's that?
Yeah, good.
I move that we accept the minutes of July 11th as they're written, with the exception of those two amendments, adding the FERCOG and adding the D.
Second?
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All right, and then we have public comment in case anybody in the public wants to say something that might not be on the agenda. Yes, sir. Yeah, actually, he said the acoustics are good, but you got to be pretty close to the mic, I think. So we usually just, these are just usually quick public comments. And
good evening. David White from Sugarloaf Street. Tonight, I'd like to address the board on the proposed 65-unit housing project for Sugarloaf Street and my concerns over groundwater, traffic, and how they're going to deal with the contaminated agricultural lands that we've dealt with in this town for 30 years. Many of you don't know it, but 30 years ago, our town wells were shut off at Sugarloaf Street because of contamination, a contamination that is never cleared today. So when we go to do this proposed development, those issues and the runoff from Mount Sugarloaf and North Sugarloaf are going to have to be addressed because it will end up with water in our cellars and cancerogenic groundwater spread further in this town. Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you. Yeah, as I said, we haven't, at the planning board, we haven't received any notification, so it hasn't been put on our agenda yet, but we have heard talk about it. So, as I said, at some point, it becomes a site plan review, and then abutters are notified.
So what's the next planning board meeting?
We got to set the date. The first Monday of September is a holiday, so it's probably the second Monday in September. That's what we usually do. Did you also have a comment?
My public comment was just sort of in support of his concern about that for this upcoming issue that maybe the board hasn't been formally addressed at, but since it's already gotten its approval from the Conservation Commission, which said there were no surface wetlands, that they would be concerned with, that obviously it's probably going to be coming before you soon, and that I think the big concern is the underground drainage that has been a previous problem with the Crestview development and apparently backing water up into the people on Eastern Ave, and because it wasn't addressed properly. And I'm sure that the same runoff from Mount Sugarloaf that is received in the land that is in question here for that subdivision will cause a similar problem to occur. But I realize it's not before you yet, but let's just say there's enough talk around that it's time to start thinking about it ahead of time.
Yep. All right, we'll make note. Do you have that sign-up sheet of who's here? We should pass that around or make sure. So if we make sure your name's on that, then we can make sure you get notified too.
John, one other comment. And again, there's a lot of speculation, myth, whatever going on. The truth is very hard to find here. I was told that there's quite possibly two curb cuts for Sugarloaf Street. And I was under the understanding that that is not a planning board issue. When you put two curb cuts on Sugarloaf Street, you can't even get out there now. And they're looking at putting a circle driveway in. It's just going to totally alter the total character of Sugarloaf Street. Mm-hmm. It's out there for the town that I love and I've grown up. Been down the street the whole life, and I just need to see it get altered in this drastic fashion.
All right. Yeah, I'm not saying that a site plan review potentially would certainly have something to do with maybe curb cuts, but the actual curb cut, if it's a state highway, then they're the ones that would authorize that. So
that's approved through the state highway, the DOT?
I believe.
Yeah.
Is that's a state road, is it?
Yeah, the state still, I think the highway, Deerfield Highway, plows it, maintains it. In the past, it's been paved by the Mass Highway. They did some drainage catch basins. The state took care of that. The town also did some sewer manholes, which that's the sewer. The town is responsible for the sewer. So I don't know how much say the state has or doesn't have, but yes, it's still maintained to a certain degree by the state.
We did. We finally got Sugarloaf nice and smooth, so you don't lose your fillings going up and you're going on triads across it for the next 10 years.
All right, thank you. Yeah. Any other public comment? All right. Item number four is a public hearing. So take care. So I'd like to open the public hearing, and I believe it's going to be pretty short. Do you have the letter?
Yeah.
I'll talk about that. So we'd like to continue the public hearing where notice is given that the Deerfield Planning Board will hold a public hearing. We've had it started on May 9th on a request received from the Alan Chase Foundation, DBA Eagle Brook School, for a site plan review regarding the proposal to install two ground-mounted solar arrays, which would connect Eagle Brook campus. And the location is zoned RA, residential agriculture. Copies of the site plan and site plan application are available for inspection at the Deerfield Town Hall.
Didn't they withdraw their application?
So between last meeting and this meeting, we got an actual, on July 26th, we received a letter, the Deerfield Planning Board, from Eagle Brook School, and I will read it regarding the ground-mounted solar array. Dear Planning Board members, on behalf of Eagle Brook School, we would like to request, without prejudice, withdrawal of the special permit application and stormwater permit application for the construction of new ground-mounted solar arrays off Keats Road and Rice's Ferry Road. The school has opted not to pursue this project at these sites. Please let us know if you have any questions. Sincerely, the Berkshire Design Group, who is working on behalf of Eagle Brook School. So, they told us they're probably going to do that last month, and then they officially made it.
So, accept that, and we don't continue the meeting.
So now we can close the public hearing, yeah.
Yes.
Want to move that?
I make a motion, we accept Eagle Brook's proposal to withdraw their request without prejudice.
I'll second it.
Any questions, comments?
Nope.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. So the hearing's closed, and there's no action we need to take.
Correct.
Excellent. So we have two A&Rs under new business, 20 Elm Street and 30 Keats Road. Is anybody here from 20 Elm Street? So we have, and 30 Keats Road, we have some people. So we have some people. We want to do that one first?
Sure.
Just change the order?
I guess we can, but.
All right. So then I want to make it, I'm a neighbor of 30, actually, is it 30? Yeah.
17.
Okay, good, because I'm not a direct neighbor of 30. So let's change that. Oh, they went with the mailing address when they filled out the thing. All right. So if you change on the agendas, let's look at it. It's an A&R for 17 Keats Road. And I am a butter of that property, so I will recuse myself from this part of the meeting. So.
Well, that creates a problem for us.
Well, that goes back to that whole thing where we started with a quorum so we could open the meeting and you can conduct business. And A&Rs usually aren't a big issue, so I would say.
Yeah, it's come up before Kip, and that's what we've done, and somebody ruled on it, and I guess that's appropriate, but obviously it's everybody's. You put their two cents in.
Well, I don't really know.
Oh, you know what I should have also, so we have, this is being recorded.
Yes.
But usually Paul takes some minutes too. Are you taking, you could take a minute?
Can't take care of this.
So you got that on recording myself.
Well, I don't know, since we don't have a quorum, I don't know if what we do is legal. Please.
I'm not sure. I'm going to trick a block. I don't know. Did you gentlemen receive the written memorandum that was in support of the A&R?
I'm going to say yes. The application.
Because it was an application.
We just received the application.
Okay.
Sure.
So what is your quorum?
Four people. There's seven members on our board.
There is a seven-member board.
There's a seven-member board.
Well, this does present a problem. Because you guys only meet once a month, is that correct?
Usually, yes.
So 21 days is going to run. So we would have...
We would have to, you know, either call another meeting and make sure that we have enough people here to deal with this. I think that might be the more appropriate way of dealing with it. I don't have a problem with going forward, but since we don't have a quorum, if somebody should challenge it in the future, then, you know.
Yes, I understand.
You know.
I take it it's probably because of vacations and things of that nature that August is a hard time to get a quorum.
Sometimes we just don't know. Usually we have at least six people here, you know, and sometimes we have all seven. I know that... besides John, there's another member who is involved with the Eagle Brook School, so she probably didn't show up because of that.
I see.
But I don't know what to...
is it Mr. Kip?
Kamosa, yes.
Okay. What is your suggestion? What's the feeling of the board? I mean, I can go over these issues and go over them again at a special hearing, or... Are you asking the applicant to move this to September
Are we sure, certain there might be a quorum in September?
Yeah.
With the recusal in mind, bearing the recusal in mind?
Well, you are probably in a better position to answer the question than I am. Is what we're going to be doing here tonight going to be deemed legal?
I'm just seeking an A&R.
Yep.
My client owns the property.
Yep.
At 17 Keats. Your chairman owns the property next door.
Right.
And my client wants to take a piece of backland that's not frontage on his existing lot and add it to another portion, add that portion of land to his lot further down the road, adjacent.
All right, well,
This is all a precursor to coming forward with a special permit for a...
Well, our problem just got solved.
All right.
Great. Let's grab some of those maps and take a peek at it.
I'm trying, I'm stuck on the line.
And you got your just in time.
Good. Thank you so much. Just in time, yeah.
Thanks, Kate.
So do you want to explain briefly, since we haven't a chance to read all of that? Are you adding or removing?
I'm taking a less than an acre piece, which on the map is shown as 2B. Right?
I see.
Which is now a portion of 17, okay? 17, the lot that's numbered 17 is made up of an original lot number 2 from an A&R in 1997.
Okay.
And a lot 2B that was added to it in 2005. All right? We're now taking that lot 2B and putting it with Mr. Maltby's adjacent land.
I see.
Okay, so it sounds strange, but we're undoing what was done in 2005.
Okay? I see. Okay.
And we're doing this as a precursor of coming here seeking a special permit for a common driveway.
I see.
There could be a technical overburdening argument pertaining to lot 2B with reference to using the driveway over your chairman's property. And we didn't want there to be any issues at all whatsoever.
Okay.
So a matter of caution, and that is why we're taking what was added in 2005 and putting it back on Mr. Maltby's other property. So that when we're done with the A&R, lot 2 will be exactly as it was when the easement was created over the adjacent property, your chairman's property.
Will lot B be conveyed into the existing land, or is it going to remain a lot as its own?
No, lot B is going to be joined with Mr. Maltby's other property.
All right.
And it doesn't change the frontage at all whatsoever.
Right, I see that.
It's all just backland.
Oh, that's. I just wanted to make sure it was going to be part of the other one, so we weren't creating a so-called landlocked.
No, no landlocked person. And this is all to be in total compliance with your special permit for a common driveway. That's really the only reason we're doing this.
Okay.
And by the way, since I wrote this memorandum, which you may not have had a chance to read, I've met with your building inspector.
Mm-hmm.
And he said he had no objection to the A&R, and indeed he said he had no objection to the special permit for the driveway.
Which
we haven't done yet.
Right.
Trying to get the A&R accomplished and then go forward with the special permit for the common driveway.
Do we have a letter from him?
I don't have any problems with you, Roger?
No. Because it looks like it's a conforming lot. You're not making it. Yep. It's still going to conform.
Yes.
So.
Yes.
Max, no, I don't have any issues.
I don't have any issues.
All right, then.
Do we have anything from Mr. Kalaszewski? No.
No,
not particularly.
But I did speak with him.
You did? Okay.
I just spoke with the building inspector last week.
Mm-hmm.
And he said he had no objections.
All right. I make a motion we accept this as it is, and we'll sign it. Second it?
Well, I guess just one question,
sure.
Maybe.
Sure.
And the other piece of property, it has his name on it, but there's really no marking on it, like, you know, 2B and Lot 2, but it's going over to the east, right? It's going to get tied into that piece of property?
If you read under 2B, it says, not a building lot, 2B combined with parcel 2, which is Mr. Maltby's other parcel. It should have been maybe clearer designated, but that's his second parcel.
Yeah. Okay, yeah.
And that other parcel, by the way, is subject to a conservation restriction. So I don't think you're ever going to see anything, you know, a statutory conservation restriction with the Franklin County Land Trust. So I don't think you're ever going to see anything with that parcel.
Oh, this one.
So you're sort of getting more land in conservation, is what it amounts to.
More. So you're looking for a second, Kip?
Yes.
I'll second it.
All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All those opposed?
Thank you very much, and thank you for showing up.
Hi, sorry, I was detained in a long line.
Oh, sign it, yeah.
Should have texted. Sign?
That's the first, right?
Yeah. Just on my pencil, I guess.
Okay, yeah. Out of curiosity, could I ask a question?
Sure.
The common driveway that you want to create, what is it going to service? You're not creating another lot, or?
No, all that we're trying to do is get the driveway that's there.
That's already.
Permitted. That's my understanding, that driveway's been used for your chairman's house and for the dwellings on my client's property since the 1930s or 40s, or since whenever they started to have that building. All we're trying to do is get that permit, so that we can get a building permit to show the driveway. And the driveway meets your, that's my understanding, the driveway's 12 foot, that's a requirement. It meets at a good angle, the grade is good. I'm hoping.
You explained it, I didn't know what.
Yeah, we're just trying to have it so it's absolutely clear we can get it permitted.
Yeah, I understand now.
And he's going to get a building permit for a new house. That's all we're trying to do.
Above board. One moment.
That's it. Don't give her that pen, she'll take it.
I'm trying. That is Max today.
We're going to share this, Kip, you know?
Oh, I got my own.
Oh, okay, maybe.
I always take the pink pen, so nobody wants it. Max has a pen, we all have pens.
Do we want to keep three of these?
You can, so I think we pass it.
Yeah.
You need. Yeah.
There you go.
Did we do this one already?
You did.
Did we do this one already? The Elm Street one?
Have a good night.
Good night, thank you. Sorry, apologize. A little anxiety, yeah, I'm sorry. I actually cut the line. I felt so badly, but.
You got here on time.
Andy didn't wait for me. He went with Roger instead.
What's that?
Andy didn't wait for me. He went with you instead.
Yeah, we chatted a little bit. It was good. It was entertaining for both of us, I hope.
Yes, definitely.
The second A&R is 20 Elm Street, Schecterly property. Does everybody have the description? And here's...
Excuse me.
No one's here to describe it to us, but I think it's pretty self-explanatory from what... You guys want to share that one?
Is Dan boycotting us these days?
Who?
Dan?
Did he do this one? Oh, yeah, usually he comes.
Yeah.
Again, so, why didn't do this before?
So what they're asking is to create lot around existing building from remaining land. And they're saying the number of existing parcels is one, number of new parcels is two. So basically, it's where the building is, just enough, just a, I don't know, 20...
Why did they go there with the water?
20 yards behind that. That's the new line they want to make, right there.
It was existing KIP when they, it was one big lot, it serviced agriculture.
Yeah.
So the, I guess the only question is, where's the frontage North Street then?
Elm Street. Well, I guess it's both.
I think they could claim it wherever they wanted to, but I would say...
Well, the back property is.
You know what I found very interesting on this?
It has to be North Street.
The town road is on their property.
Oh, I'm looking at this the wrong way.
Which, North Street or the railroad?
No, Elm Street.
Elm Street.
Oh, Elm Street.
You look at the little circle, the island and the railroad tracks. The town road is on private property.
The concrete walkway.
Where the concrete walk is
the island.
Is town?
Well, the island's there, but there's actually pavement. Part of the travel way is on their property.
On their property.
See, right. This? Yep, right there. This is the edge of the road, and the sidewalk. It's a road.
Wow. Well, that was nice of them to...
I wonder if they can put up a toll booth.
So, I mean, the address, they're saying it's 1220 Elm Street.
Okay.
This new lot doesn't have any frontage on Elm Street.
It does. Lot 1?
Lot 1 does.
No, well, lot 2.
Lot 2 is on North
Street.
Does.
North Street.
2 is North Street.
Yeah, North Street, they're going to get their frontage from. I don't know if it says it in their description, but...
Well, it doesn't. That's why I'm just saying.
Okay.
Because currently it's called 1220 Elm Street, apparently. That's what it says on the application.
Yep.
So what I'm saying is they...
So they're creating a new address.
So when does that... That's, I guess, a separate procedure then to go try to get
create
that...
Create a new address for the second property.
So we're... So if we approve this, if we endorse it, we're creating a property with no Elm Street frontage.
But North Street frontage.
Right, but who makes that
Don't
decision?
Don't you think they get that when they get to the Registry of Deeds, they readdress
yeah.
it?
Yeah,
I think would. That's not a us thing, that's a them thing, the registry.
That's what I've never seen this where this happens, so as long as that happens, I guess it's fine. But at the same time, we're not saying that's a building lot. They would have to go and determine that.
Well, they're both large enough in that area to be building lots anyway, so.
Yeah, I'm so screwed.
And they got the frontage.
And they do have, down in the bottom left-hand corner, it says that endorsement of the A&R does not certify that the lots shown qualify as building lots, so.
I'm good.
So that's what Dan is good at writing now. Remember, he didn't used to write that, and now he's writing.
He has had the SOP.
He does a lot of plans around here, huh?
What's that?
Dan does a lot of
Yeah,
work
he
on.
Does a lot of
He does
As far as size and shape and all the rest of it, it's
Must be
okay.
reasonable.
Yeah, well, Sterling Nelson did some for a while, but then I think he retired.
What's the, I'm sure this is okay, the lot size of lot 1 being 25,000?
Yeah, in that area, I think it only has to be
This is
12.
It's a CR.
This is Center Village, so it can be smaller.
No, it's,
Isn't it?
No, it's C1.
C1.
But I think that's 12,000.
Oh, C1.
Oh, good. Lot size, 15,000 square feet. Frontage, 125, setback. All right. All right, so we have a motion?
I make a motion, we accept the A&R as it is.
I'll second it.
Any discussion? Do you have the original application? Because I'd actually like to see that they, did they pay? You can't tell on this thing whether they paid. And actually, the chair should, and he should do it for the other one, sign, there's a place on page two? Sorry.
It's a two-page application.
Yeah, I can see the other one. But there were a couple pages, but this is the only one that was given to me in the file.
So Kip, for that other one, that's, I usually sign. So that's the other one. Date plans were endorsed. I put, I checked that and I put my initials to give, so they know. All right, so this, they, it's been received by the town and they paid 150, which is correct. And we'll just have to ask them to do page two. All right, so there's been a motion and a second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstained?
5-0. Keep this together with that other one?
5-0-0. So I just put approved down.
John, is there a particular place that we keep these? Give them back to her?
Give them back and I think it goes to the building inspector then. There you go. I'm going to take that. That's the other one. And then this is this one. All right, we only have three paper and one. I know, you kind of got to look at them separate. Oh, no, this is the one. So I actually, maybe I should have said this earlier. So John Baronis did call me last Thursday, I think, and said he apologizes for not making tonight and the past couple meetings. He is in a situation where his work has him out of town and he doesn't come home some on these nights. Max, you know about that. And so, you know, he sort of said, if I need to resign, let me know. But he hopes that by September, October, he'll be coming again. So I said, well, and then tonight he would have had to recuse himself from this one.
Right.
Because he had something to do with this property.
Yeah, he owns the building maybe or something, yeah. What's that?
He sold that, didn't he?
Well.
And I think Paul might have told us at the last meeting
business,
that he was on holiday.
That he wasn't going to make it.
Yeah. I'm sorry. I just
the
got home late.
Yeah, well.
And then I went to sit online.
Okay.
I should have cut.
All right, it looks like we did. No, this one didn't get there.
Mm-hmm. We didn't find the Mylar either.
Oh, that's why. Wait, what did you give her? Did you?
This one? Nope, that's one. I gave her a copy of it.
That's the original, because I like it, because that's the one that says that they actually paid and stuff, so.
All right, I'll sign it, bring it over to you.
That's a good one to have.
This is yours.
All right, so that's, that next on the agenda is discussion bylaws, chapter 179, section 2300, dimensional requirements.
For primarily the height, we had spoken briefly about it in the past, and recently one of the schools had to go before the ZBA to get a variance for that. So I thought maybe there's something else pending the same, so I thought we could bring it up and maybe, if we're going to change it, save somebody some additional paperwork.
Was that a certain zone or just in general?
I guess just in general. I mean, I don't really know, but from my understanding is the height limitation was primarily because of the fire department's request not being able to get up high enough. But since we've had a ladder truck for, I don't know, a dozen years or so, it seems like we might consider increasing that.
What is it right now?
Is it 35?
35 feet.
35 feet.
And what would we?
I don't know, 50 feet.
Well, the other part of that is then we'd be buying the ladder truck. Didn't, when they put it, didn't whoever put up the building that was that high have to do something about the ladder truck? No? We bought the ladder truck.
And I just want, maybe Kip can refresh my memory. What you said a school came in, mm-hmm. and I think I know what you're talking about, but what school was it, Kip?
It was Deerfield Academy.
Yep, and that's the one I'm thinking of. And I think they granted them the variance or whatever they needed, but I don't think it was living space.
No,
it was just a tower-like.
Right.
So that was some of the reason why they granted it to them.
And then the town went out and bought a ladder truck.
I think it wasn't because of that.
I think it wasn't related.
They just bought one because
right.
of...
The town's had a ladder truck, I think, for about a dozen years now.
Yeah.
Maybe not quite that long.
I don't know how long they've had it,
but
it wasn't because of that issue.
No, because this was just recently where the academy came in.
Well, it's going to be quite a while, Kip, I think. It's that tower?
Oh, no. It's a new building that they're working on now.
Oh.
It's not even built yet.
Well, I know they came in...
For another one.
Yes, in the past.
Right.
And they got a special permit or a variance or something?
Whatever they needed, because they said it was no living space.
Right. Right.
And I'm not aware of the one that he's talking about, the new one.
Right.
But it was a dormitory that was off of Old Main Street to the east.
And that's that little
yes.
biggie part.
Up. Yeah.
That well, I would, in general, for smart growth purposes, going up is actually a good thing.
Yeah.
But I would say let's contact the fire department and see what their recommendation on height is, because I think it is they're the ones that might
that's
have an opinion on it. So,
mm-hmm. All right.
And you have to buy another one.
But the
question was, how high can your truck go?
There you go.
We don't want to change it. We need a bigger truck, so we'll make sure we're within their reach.
So this is always my question. So if you can have in the minutes that we want to get comment from the fire department, but then how do we actually... is that something you could follow up on?
I'll go and I'll talk with
it's
Bill.
It's simple enough. But
yep. You need to talk with both districts.
Yes.
Right.
But I can reach out to Chet as well.
Yeah.
So.
But I do remember that was the reason why someone said it was 35, and I think a lot of towns that was the
yeah,
what
it was.
Used to
I
be,
remember
and now
the
everybody
conversation.
Has better
but even myself, 15 years ago, I hadn't received the same type of variance because I put up a building. And even though it was just a cupola that was on top
that's
of it, it was 37 feet, so I had to go through the whole
that's
thing.
That's what the Deerfield County thing is. It's like
right, and that's
right.
silly. So, I mean, it doesn't, well, it's not silly, but
well,
probably
it is
different.
Silly, but there's probably a lot of reasons, sight,
to do it.
Line
mm-hmm.
of sight and stuff like that. So
yeah.
there's more to it than just putting the fire out.
But I think that it, warrants some good debate because... on one hand, you don't want to get a building that's, very tall, that has living quarters or whatever. versus a building that was, say it was located on a piece of land where this particular portion of the building was only 30 feet, but because the grade went down, this section was now 55. So, you know, you have to go by the highest portion of it, so.
Think about that. When you pass through Northfield, center of Northfield, you know, there's not like a 4 or 5-story apartment building. It's actually for sale again.
Yeah.
It's really tall. When you think about it, that's significantly taller than every other building in
An older building, Rachel?
An older building, yep. Lots of fire escapes on the outside. Must be a multi.
Well, how tall? Wasn't there was a couple of buildings in town that right in the center that were quite tall.
Redmond's Hall was probably the tallest, and that was maybe, I don't know if it was really 3 stories, but there was like, and I've never was in it, but supposedly there was like a hall upstairs.
Upstairs.
And it might have been just 2 stories, but it was a
tall
ceiling.
Yeah.
And that's probably the tall, you know, I can remember. Oh, actually, where Cowan's,
yep.
There was a plastic manufacturer there, and that was really tall at one time, yes.
But that was all manufacturing, wasn't it, Mr. Mitchell?
What's that?
It was all manufacturing.
Yeah, but there was people up there and stuff, yeah.
So I will look into that.
All right, so if you look into that, and as you were finishing that discussion, I started looking at the mail in front of us, and the first one I come to is a request for comments to the planning board from Deerfield Academy, and they want our, who wants our comments? The Zoning Board of Appeals wants our comments regarding the variance from Bylaw 179, Article 2, Section 2300, from 35-foot height to a height not to exceed 54 feet for Deerfield Academy ice rink and sports facility.
Mm. Yeah. There you go.
So it sounds like our comment is
timely.
We're okay with it? Or we have no objection? What's our comment?
I wouldn't have any objection, because I think that one is exactly what I was talking about, where it's the majority of the building is at the same level. Is that called Albany Road, where they're...
Yes.
27 Albany Road and 4 Little Meadow Road.
Right, but then the land drops down, so there's access from that lower level, which makes the building taller.
Like the swimming pool.
Yeah.
So this was according to this, the Zoning Board of Appeals met on July 21st. And then, so I don't know what their ruled, but then they wanted comments, so probably they didn't make a final ruling. They probably got to get comments from the fire department and others.
Yeah, I would say their comments are more probably valuable than our
So
thoughts.
We're just no objection. I mean, we don't have to say much more than
sitting
that.
Sitting right here, it is.
I think they did approve it, though.
John, that was under these papers here.
The paper.
That looks like it's in ink. It's the original.
There's another original.
Wow. She had one, too.
You had one with the red and everything on it.
Right, but one of those 3 has had the actual original and the other are color scanned.
Okay.
Can you
pass
them over there?
Yeah. Okay.
You can pick one.
You have to check on the back. This looks like...
They're all staples.
Yeah, this looks like the real thing.
Yeah?
Yep.
All right, so that's good. We got to act on that piece of mail. There's another, the Zoning Board of Appeals, June 16th. Why are we just getting, they had a hearing pursuant to an order of remand issued by the Franklin Superior Court pursuant to civil action relating to the issuance of a frontage variance for property located at 82 Waitley Road, Deerfield. So I don't know what that was, but it's passed, I guess.
It's for Henry Sukowski's land.
Is that the one John Moronis was talking about? Mm-hmm. So that's...
Let's see, if I was reading through our book, and I don't know, you might be aware of it, I wasn't, that the planning board can grant special permits for building lots that don't meet the frontage requirement.
Jeez.
And I thought it was quite interesting because they went through and they cited a whole, like, 5 or 6 different court cases and how it all came about and the actions.
It's in our book?
Yeah, that's what I thought was so interesting. Where? I thought I had it down here. The process for approving building lots lacking adequate frontage. and it cites, and it's pretty good, whoever put this together, and it talks all about, you know, these people who, you know, let's just, for example, you need a 200-foot frontage, but they only had 170, and, you know, the planning board turned them down and the ZBA turned them down. Then when they went to court, you know, all of the things went through, and it, you know, was there adequate this, was there adequate that, you know, blah, blah. And in every case, the landowner ended up winning. It was successful. So, and this is on page 77 of the book, so maybe we, you know, should take over the next month, read it and digest it a little bit, and we can talk about it.
Which section is it?
It doesn't really say a section. Wait a minute.
Does that get me?
It's not in our zoning bylaws. It's beyond.
It's in section 11 of our
11?
Book. Yeah, section 11, and it's on page, it starts on page.
It's got page numbers.
Starts on page 77.
There it is. I see it. Process for approving building lots lacking adequate frontage. It's in this A&R handbook. Which is old.
And where it all comes by is that it basically says that if you don't have a bylaw to address it, then this is what happens.
So get on your bylaws.
And that's why I thought it was interesting, because since we don't have a bylaw that addresses it.
We don't have a bylaw that addresses what, though?
Think about it. It's kind of like the chicken and the egg type thing.
Right.
We have a bylaw that says the minimum frontage.
Right.
Okay. And this is the process for approving building lots lacking adequate frontage, meaning they don't have the requirement that meets our town minimum. But then it goes in and it talks about the law saying, in the absence of zoning bylaw provisions, you know, we get to authorize the reduction. So there's no real set size is what it's saying. But it seems kind of foolish, because if we had a process for making it smaller, then somebody could come in and say they want it smaller, you know?
But you just said in the absence of zoning regulations, we could do that. But we have zoning regulations.
No, it says in the absence of just...
Of zoning, you know, not having adequate frontage. In other words, you're supposed to have something to deal with that in place.
Oh, I see what you're saying. You know? Okay.
So maybe if... This is just off the top of my head now, I'm winging it. If it says we're supposed to have 200, then we're supposed to have something that says, okay, well, we might let you have 175 if you had so much more square footage, or, you know, something along that line. Some process.
And so you're saying if, because we don't have that in place, when they go to court, the applicant wins and they can build on a smaller lot. That doesn't make sense to me.
It doesn't say a smaller lot. It just says, you know, not having adequate frontage. So in this particular case, I was reading it, and the applicant had 4.6 acres of land, but he was 28 feet short of meeting that.
Yeah.
So that's why they won it. And then the next time they went, the next case uses the first case, and then that's how it starts piggybacking.
Yeah,
you know?
Yeah.
It'd be worth looking through.
Yeah, it's kind of interesting. You can see how the process works.
This handbook, which is useful, I have looked at this, is from 2009. It must be updated at some point. There must be other, you know what I'm saying? This would be something
that would
be interesting.
Which section is that in?
That's section 11. That's what you're reading out of is the...
See, I don't have that in my book. Yeah. Mine was a newer.
So that'd be an interesting thing, because this is from Deval Patrick. So you wonder if this is going to change with the A&R or...
Well, the whole zoning might be changing soon in the state, but I don't know if that has anything to do with it.
It'd be a good thing to read.
You have a lot of mail there.
I know. If anybody ever wants to open this in the office, that's terrific. Most of them are just from neighboring towns. So one other thing that's... all right, so we're good with that?
Yep.
So the other thing on the agenda, or that's not on the agenda, is committee appointments. CP...
C.
Community Preservation, you still want to do that?
Yes, if you guys will let me.
We'll let you. But I was told to tell you you got to go.
I try to go, but sometimes they don't notify me. I'll look in the paper or whatever.
Yeah.
That's the issue.
I think it's...
Yep.
There's some shakeup in the CPC, too, because Dan Graves, who's been the chair, has to step away because he's a moderator now.
Oh.
He was on there?
He was the chair.
Of the community?
Of the CPC, yeah.
Yeah.
And he was the moderator's, he was the moderator's appointee, so they have to have another appointee, the moderator does, i.e. him. And so there's a little shakeup, because I'm actually the, I'm the select board appointee.
What, John, were you, see, I get with all these acronyms, were you talking about community preservation or the capital improvement? Or both?
Actually, capital improvement is who sent me, sent us an email.
So capital improvement, so you want to do them both?
Yeah.
You're on that, you're on that.
Yes, capital improvement and community preservation.
But a couple of months ago, we talked about that we wanted to have, as a full planning board, more involvement with capital planning, because we felt like capital planning is planning. Remember, you.
Right, yeah, we've talked a lot about that.
Yeah, but I was talking two different things. The capital, and forgive me if I'm making mistakes, the capital improvement committee not only deals with, you know, buildings and structures, but also, you know, ambulances, other things that go on, improvements to the town. And what I was referring, equipment to, you know, things like that, whether it's AC units for the town hall.
Oh, okay.
What I was talking about is when they're either building new buildings or rehabbing buildings to get involved, because that's part of our state charter charge or whatever, if you will, at the planning board, so, you know.
Well, a neighboring town of ours, well, it's not really a neighboring town, but like Amherst, I believe, they have, when the town does something, because there were some complaints about how the town went along doing stuff, that they still need to jump through all the hoops that a regular applicant has to. They got to come into the front of the planning board, and so we look at lighting, screening, and all that stuff.
The town does.
I think that's a very good policy, so everybody's on an even keel,
right.
And.
Well, I'm going to say something that maybe I'll get my hand slapped on, but I had a chuckle under my breath. A little more than a year ago, there were some people that came in, and they were going to put up a new building on the Oxford property. And the planning board didn't have anything to do with site plan review or stormwater thing, and I was upset. But the night that the applicant came in, the planning board was in the kitchen, and we were brought an A&R that had absolutely no numbers on it. Do you remember that?
Yeah.
So we chose to take no action because there were no numbers on it.
Right.
Well, guess what? Now that people are going to buy Oxford property, their lawyer called up and said they went to registry team. They go, hey, Deerfield, we got a map with no numbers on it. They filed it that way, too.
Oh, good.
Oh,
so
no.
Now, yep, so now, I don't know, we're in the process of trying to get numbers on the map.
Wow. So they just filed it without our...
Without endorsement?
And not an A&R.
Yes, they did.
Which, after 21 days, they can do.
They can do. They didn't heed our notification. Hey, yeah. There needs to be numbers on it.
Yeah.
There's a reason we didn't do this. So, you know, I made a point to... I went through my planning board meeting, and I found the date and everything, and I notified my other board members of exactly how they ended up in this position.
Wow.
Yeah.
Interesting. All
right. So what should we have done should we have not approved it?
We didn't approve
it.
But, I mean, do we not vote on it? It's my question.
It wasn't our...
We voted to take no action because there was no numbers. We had no idea where it was or anything. So now there's a concern as to where Merrigan Way actually sits on the land. Very similar to what we just saw on that A&R where the town road was. Well, we don't know if that's not happening again with Merrigan Way.
Wow.
Yeah, I know.
That's why they oversee instead of us, yeah.
Yeah. It's a select board.
Right, select board problem.
Yeah.
Does it have numbers now? Have you seen it?
Yeah. It didn't.
It didn't?
It didn't. It's not unless they just got a new one, but I know that Doug was in touch with him, but I was like, this is what was happening, you know.
So the other committee, that is the Franklin Regional Council of Governments, wants us to have a rep on the Franklin Regional Planning Board, and it has been John Baronis, and I need to check and say if it's the same person or a new person. I know he's always expressed interest in, he liked attending those meetings, and he would usually give us an update.
Yep.
So I haven't heard that he wants to get off.
Hmm.
So should we leave him on unless anybody else wants to?
No, he's good.
All right.
I can't go to any more meetings.
Yeah.
I just can't go to any more meetings.
All right, so that we got to turn. Any interesting, or any mail that we should discuss?
There is.
And then the last item, I need some advice, is, so we heard earlier in the public comment about this Gritz property. It hasn't come to us, although I have received an email from the town administrator saying it might be coming to us. And they wanted to have, there was a proposal to have preliminary meetings with key players, that is, the different committees that might be involved. And those meetings are supposed to be to just make sure all the process goes properly. Like, when does it go to the zoning board, the CONCOM, the planning board, whoever else it needs to go to. And the request was made to have have Pat Smith go to some of these meetings as representing the planning board, so that when it does come to us, we're up to date and things like that. So my question is, if it hasn't even come to us, how can we start spending money on our consultant?
I don't want to speak for the applicant, but I, you know, if I was the applicant, you go to everybody. You know, you submit it to the town, and the town disseminates it to the planning board, to the conservation commission, to whomever that
and
needs
to
go. And then we act on it. We put it on our agenda. And then, you know, I know in the past, sometimes if, say, there was a piece of work that needed to go before the zoning board of appeals, that they might not want to take action until the planning board, or vice versa. Well, that we could get together with that board and, you know, coordinate it. But until it comes before us, I mean,
There's been some debate, like, should it come to the planning board first, or should it go to the zoning board of appeals, because they could just say no, and then it's a moot point anyways. So that was always a debate, and I don't know who's going to make the decision where it should go first.
If in reading our bylaws, they need to make the determination whether or not they need to go to the zoning board of appeals.
The applicant?
The applicant. If they need to go to the zoning board of appeals first to know if that process is permissible,
open to them,
then they go there. Mm-hmm. Then they come to the planning board for site plan review, stormwater, and things like of that nature. And there's no reason that couldn't be, you know, coordinated.
What about the accessory apartment and the movement in Greenfield?
Sorry. On that, so I'm going to report back that we don't want to start paying our consultant
to do that until it's actual.
Right.
Because
we need it.
And I did get an inquiry about when is our September meeting, because that project might be on that month's agenda. So that'll be great. If it's there, then we can start to make some action on it.
Exactly.
And again, I think we're one of the few that actually have these public hearings. Although I thought the CONCOM.
They do. They have public hearings.
But how come, did they have it?
Yeah, as far as I know, I didn't see it, but someone talked about it. It was televised, and as much as the person that watched it said that, they said there was no wetlands, and maybe, I don't know if it changed, but it was like, maybe the process was determination.
Oh,
you know,
intended,
see if there was any wetlands.
Right.
Yeah, so I don't know, but
because,
supposedly,
I mean,
it happened.
The two abutters who were here said they didn't get noticed, so maybe it wasn't the kind of public hearing where you have to inform the abutters, maybe.
Well, I don't believe they're really abutters.
Site determination. Oh.
There might be abutters to abutters, but I don't know what the rules
if they're not
are
within
saying.
This.
Yeah, the ones across the road and
the other ones down
way
the
down.
Yeah.
Well, I do think that the planning board is the one that people look at as having the more open meeting, so I think
it. Yeah, I think all of them have, you know, the zoning board, conservation.
So when we, so when we get it, and we'll make a schedule of how we're going to deal with it, when our meetings will be, and then we'll hire our consultant, you know, peer review or whatever we decide. So,
all right, I will inform them of that.
Thanks. And then you had a question about.
It's fine. I'm going to do a little bit more reading. I mean, it's been in the paper. Greenfield's looking at it. The state's looking at accessory apartment regulations. I think it's something. You know, it came. We talked about it before.
Yep.
I think it's going to come up again. I think it's something worth just looking at our regs and watching carefully what's happening at the state level.
I think our regulations, from when I read them, they're kind of all over the place.
They're all over the place,
And the worst part about it is it makes it difficult that if somebody does it for a parent.
Right.
Then when the parent passes.
Now what do you do with that?
You know, and I think that, you know, as long as you're not making huge additions onto buildings, you know, it's something that's, it's just something we need to address.
Yeah, I agree.
So just on a related topic, I attended the select board meeting last week when the director of the Regional Housing Authority was there, and there's potential that the town might get some money for rehabbing houses for seniors in particular, to put in bars and things like that, you know, handlebars or whatever you call them. So, but we did, we kind of did start a discussion about that housing production plan that we did 2 or 3 years ago, and that accessory apartment and other affordable housing and what's going on. So it seemed like there was a little bit of traction at the select board that, that might kind of regroup a little bit. Is that fair to say, or?
You know, no, my take on it is that this group was interested to get something going. I don't think, or at least from my point of view, the select board's not against it at all. We're very much for it. You know, but I think as far, I think our job pretty much ends as, you know, having these people reach out for grant money than, you know, passing it through. But I think more of the responsibility would fall on this board to make it, you know, workable, you know.
So being open to, I think part of the reason why these things don't move forward is because we're all volunteers and stuff. So the question is, would the Regional Housing Authority be helpful? And it seems like they might be.
It'd be one source, I think. One place to explore with. But I think other towns, bigger towns have much more elaborate accessory apartment regulations than we do. Ours aren't really,
I think that's something that we could hammer out, you know, as far as what we want, how big we want it.
That's what I think.
You know, things like that.
Right. Separate versus attached and size.
I don't think it's anything we need to have a study on. So.
No, but just some looking around.
But it would be a town meeting vote. We could make suggestions.
But I mean, just some exploratory stuff, just on from us, start that way. And capitalize on some of the research, say, Greenfield is doing, because they are.
All right, the only other observation I have in the mail is there are two, a lot of these are from zoning boards from the neighboring towns, two things that come over up and up again is like garages, or people want to build that and they need a variance or a special permit, and the other is solar panels.
Yeah.
There must be, out of these 20 letters, there must be 8 of them that, and I think part of it is they might not have as good a zoning, they might not have done their solar bylaw like we did, because they have to come and get a special permit or a variance each time.
Wow.
Some of them are smaller units, you know, smaller arrays they're putting up. So I thought that was interesting. Nice.
So they're probably more restrictive, so.
Right, so like almost everything has to. Like one or two panels, they have to go to the
board. I personally haven't seen anything go up in town that I thought was objectionable.
I mean, most people are going for roof mounted anyway. That's the most sensible.
And you don't really notice it that much.
Nope. And you don't need a.
All right, so can we set our September?
I think we talked last month about doing it on the 12th of September.
I think I even have it.
What was the date, Kip, on September the 12th?
So the 5th, which is our normal one, is Labor Day. So you go to the next Monday?
Next Monday.
That often presents a problem for you?
Is that the second Monday?
Second Monday.
Yeah, I wouldn't be able to attend.
About the.
Do you want to do it like this Tuesday
13th?
The 6th?
Or Tuesday the 6th?
Tuesday the 6th.
Or the 13th?
I can't attend.
How about the 13th?
You can't attend, John?
No, the first Tuesday is always.
Yeah, I know.
I have
you
my board
some,
meeting.
Yeah,
at
yeah.
My
but how about the 13th? The second, I mean, how about.
Or the Thursday the 8th?
I'm good with that, too.
Yeah.
Do we run into other meetings here?
I'm good.
There's no. What other. Who meets on Thursdays usually, you know?
Nobody.
Zoning.
Nobody at that time of night.
Yeah, I don't know. Like conservation, I thought met on Thursdays, but I don't know when they have them.
Depending on our schedule, I mean, we could either go into the conference room.
Okay.
Yeah, we don't need this.
Depends
what we're dealing with.
All right, so let's set it for Thursday, September 8th. Could you inform Doug, because I had told him it was most likely the 12th, but I said we'd get back to him.
So.
Yeah. Yep. Excellent. All right, and I'll make sure John and Paul know about it too. Excellent, anything else?
I mean, September 8th.
September.
Hearing nothing, any motion to adjourn?
I make a motion to adjourn.
Second.
I second.
Second, third, fourth, all those in favor?
Aye.
Thank you very much.